Well, good morning, everybody. Good morning. Welcome to church on this beautiful day that we have today. I'm glad that you got here safely. For anybody who might be watching on the live stream at home because it was kind of too treacherous to drive, we're glad you're joining us. That's what this camera is for, if you're here and wondering what that's about. We have lots of people following us online every week, and it's a cool, nice tool that we have for people, especially weeks like this when it's a little bit difficult to get to church. But I'm glad that you're all here. If you're new to church, my name is Pastor PJ. It is really, really great to have you here. If you are new to us, there's a connect card in the pew in front of you. We ask if you would please fill that out at some point in the service, and you can put it in the offering plate as it goes by. That's our way of we really want to try to make connections with people in the church, not just have them stop by and, you know, not get to know us, but we really do want to be able to connect with as many people as possible. So that is one way we decide to try to prioritize that. But there's a bunch of really good, important announcements coming up. Some are in your bulletin. Actually, a lot of them are in your bulletin. Some are on the screen. But I wanted to first invite up Michelle Reinagel from our outreach team. She has some news about our outreach involving the food pantry that she wants to give some information about. So thank you, Michelle, for being willing to share. Hopefully that mic works.
Good morning. So first, I just wanted to share a verse with you from Proverbs 19:17. It says, "Whoever is kind to the poor lends to the Lord, and he will reward them for what they have done." And you know, when I thought about that verse, I thought, how cool is that, that we can actually lend to the Lord? I mean, he has everything, right? But the fact that we can lend to the Lord through our care for the poor in our community is an awesome thing. So one of our primary ministries here at Trinity is the Frewsburg Food Pantry. And I was just wondering, how many of you know where the box is for the Frewsburg Food Pantry here at Trinity? Okay, good. More than I thought would know where it is. So that's awesome. But we are going to be having a collection coming up on February 2nd for the food pantry. And you will see in our entryway, we have a shopping cart. In the shopping cart are these bags. And it even gives you a little shopping list on here of things that the food pantry is wanting and needing to collect. So we are encouraging you to please bring in some of these items on February 2nd. That's, I think, our first service where we're going to be having two services. So we're hoping to fill that basket. We're hoping to fill the table. We're going to have a table in the entryway just as you come in for any goods that you bring in. And we are very excited about this opportunity to give to the food pantry. And I would just like to thank you as a part of the outreach committee for the anybody who donated to the Christmas baskets. Anybody who gave food to that provided for 62 families. Nice. That was 4 infants, 9 toddlers, 86 children, 116 adults, and 15 senior citizens. So thank the Lord, and thank you for anybody who brought in those donations. And I'm excited to see that table out there filled with lots of food for our food pantry February 2nd, the first February. So first Sunday in February, I should say. So thank you very much.
Quick question, are we going to have the first Sunday of every month be sort of bring your items for the food pantry Sunday? So I know we want to have it be something we always continually give to, and we can, of course, if you have stuff the third Sunday, bring it. But we want the first Sunday of the month to be sort of our big push, so that if you go shopping later on in the month, you can bring your items that day. So Thank you, outreach team. You do a great job keeping us organized and focused on what we need to be doing as a church regarding serving our community and beyond. So that's really good. Michelle mentioned that on February 2nd, we are moving to two services. I spoke about that kind of a lot last Sunday. If you missed that message, you can go on our website and listen to that. I kind of rolled out some of the schedule and the reasoning behind that. So we will have an 8:30 service downstairs, 9:30 will be Sunday school, and then we will meet here at 10:30. So a little bit different, so make sure you're aware of that, put that in your calendars. That's February 2nd. Justin, do you have, regarding outreach, you guys, yeah. The worship team's
so
doing something?
You ever wanna do something, but you're like, I don't know what my skill set is, and we finally found something. We were asked to be a part of Soup in a Song, which Jim Holler, who's here, has been asked to start back up at the soup kitchen. It's someplace that our outreach team has also served alongside, but we were asked to bring a team, a band, that would do some music for that night. So January 30th, Jim, is it 6 to 8? 6 to 8 at the Soup Kitchen in Jamestown. We're going to be playing, and we've just some of our team members are going to go down there and play, and I think it's $10, and you get 3 or 4 different kinds of soup and some of their other breads and things. It's going to be really cool, and it's all to benefit the Soup Kitchen. So our team is like, hey, neat. We get an opportunity to use what we enjoy doing anyways to honor God and to serve. So not that we aren't doing that here now, but in an outreach sense. So that's January 30th, I believe. That's a Thursday. So come out and join us down at the Soup Kitchen from 6 to 8. I believe it's $10 per adult. I don't know 100% of the pricings, but we will put that out on our social medias.
Well, so you're saying you're using your gifts to serve not just in the church, but beyond the church? Weird.
You should talk about that sometime.
I might talk about that sometime. Okay. All right. Lastly, we have we've not done a finance team update in a while. There's some things that we want to update everybody on. So our current finance team chair, Tim Lyon, is here to give a quick update on where we're at financially and some goals that we've set. Thanks, Tim, for being here.
It's outgoing financial chairperson. Good morning, everyone. I'm here, as PJ said, on behalf of the finance team and the church council. As you know, we undertook a project last year. The roof needed replaced on our building, and the finance team and church council kind of got some people together and said, hey, maybe we should look at doing some other things while we're at it. And as you've heard every week here in church and in the midweek, we've been raising money to do some remodeling efforts in the downstairs of the church. And also the other phase was to raise enough money to add air conditioning to the sanctuary. So we've been monitoring that, and a lot of you have been giving on a regular basis throughout the year. And the goal was to make sure we had the money in hand before we began anything. So we were able to do the roof because we had saved a long time before. We had the money in the bank to pay for that. And then the downstairs, we didn't undertake any of those remodeling until we actually had money in the bank to pay for them. So that left only one last phase, which was to raise enough money to install air conditioning in the sanctuary for the warm months ahead. So we've been monitoring that.
Hey, Tim, I love you. Everybody's going to fall asleep. Do you have anything exciting to announce for us this morning?
Oh, yes, I guess I do, PJ. We took a look at the numbers and the giving through the end of the year, and as you know, the goal was to be done by the end of the year, and fortunately, we made our goal!
Yeah, so we made our goal. We set a goal to have our Build for the Future campaign. I'm not usually that mean to Tim. If you're new and you're like, that pastor's the meanest pastor. I love Tim, and that was meant to be like that. We raised all the money we set out to raise throughout December, so if you have been planning to continue to give toward that, you can stop that. We appreciate everybody. So many people have given way above and beyond their tithe and have budgeted for giving to the Build to the Future campaign. We've been able, like Tim said, the roof is done, downstairs is done, now we have enough money to finish phase three, which is air conditioning in here, which we don't need today, but in June we will. And so it'll be a really good thing for us going forward. The whole heart behind this was not have a nicer building, but build for the future. How can our building be equipped for ministry for decades to come? And I really thank everybody who's been a part of it. If you're new to church and you're like, this is the craziest church ever, I'm glad that you're here. Sometimes we have staff meeting and then the word confetti cannon is thrown out and I get really excited.
And it wasn't us.
It was Karen, right?
It was Karen. Just saying.
So. So if your pacemaker is on the fritz or anything right now, you can email Karen Davis. Her email's in the bulletin.
Send all your angry emails.
So yeah, we're really excited that this is completed. We do want to celebrate that. We are going to have we're going to be in the works as planned a dinner to celebrate what God has been able to do in our church. And we want to not just have it be blowing off confetti cannons in the church. We want to celebrate it right and talk about what this is meaning and what we're going to be doing going forward. So this is really exciting. Brendan promised to clean up all the confetti after church. So thank you, Brendan. I appreciate your servanthood in that way. But yeah, that's there's been lots of announcements. We did want to celebrate this right because it is a big thing. We've raised, $34,200 in less than a year, which is, and our budget's still in a good place, and so we're doing well. In all seriousness, if you do have questions regarding our finances, you can talk to Tim and he will either answer your question or direct you to another member of the finance team. We do want to make our finances and our budgets that we set known to everybody. So if you have questions about that, please talk to Tim. But we want to celebrate this. God's been doing some really great stuff and think affirming what we have been setting out to do, that this is not just about us wanting nice things for our church. This is about our building and our resources being equipped for ministry for many, many years. And so thank you for everybody who has given to this, for your diligent above and beyond giving. It has been really good. And so we give God all the glory for it. So why don't I pray? And as I pray, why don't you stand as we start actual worship this morning after the confetti settles. God, you are good. And we are here to give you all the praise and glory for everything you're doing. We pause and reflect on your goodness, on your faithfulness, on your answered prayers, on when you call us to make faithful steps that maybe sometimes give us pause. You provide and you walk with us. So thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness, your provision. May we continually seek your face as we go forward and not have this church be about any one of us or our preferences or whatever, but Lord, seeking you out for what is right, whether it's difficult or not. So Lord, may we be constantly keeping our eyes on Jesus as we go forward and as we do ministry together. We love you and we praise you. We pray all this in Christ's holy name. Amen.
I see the work of your hands, galaxy spinning, a heavenly dance. Oh God, all that you are, so overwhelming. And I hear the sound of your voice. All at once it's a gentle and thundering noise. Oh God, all that you are, so overwhelm me. I delight myself in you, captivated by your beauty. I'm overwhelmed. Because of mercy, I'm
Praise
invite the 4-year-olds through 4th grade. They can go down to Children's Church with Lindsay and Ryan. If you'd like to do that, if you'd like to stay in service, you're certainly welcome. As the little ones are head out, let's pray together. Let's just give God a moment of our quiet attention before him. Lord, we just sang and proclaimed amen. A declaration of trust. It's not just a way to end a prayer. It's saying, Lord, we lay this at your feet and we trust you with it. Lord, we know that you can handle it. So Lord, whatever is on our hearts this morning, we sing amen, knowing that you are in control and that you can handle it. And so Lord, we lift up to you those who are in a really tough spot right now, maybe with their health or with their finances or with their marriage or with their kids or with their jobs, whatever it might be, or with you, struggling to see you, struggling to know where you are at and where you're answering prayer and how. So all these things, Lord, we say amen, knowing that you can handle it. We lay it at your feet. We leave it at your altar. We trust you with it. And Lord, we lift up Wendy Langford, who is just suffering now, Lord, dealing with pneumonia on top of battling cancer. And so, Lord, we lift up our sister to you. We pray for your healing. We pray for you to intervene. For all those on our prayer list, for those spoken and unspoken, people battling cancer, battling illnesses, facing surgery, recovering from surgery, waiting for the right appointment to come through, whatever it might be, Lord, we pray for their healing. We just sang, you are greater, stronger, and higher than anything that we will face. And that is our prayer, that is our declaration, not just a song that's fun to sing. It is a declaration of who our God is. So Lord, we trust you with these things. We trust you with our individual finances and our church finances. We trust you as we seek your face. Maybe having an incredible week of encountering you daily. Or maybe it's been months since we've opened up the Bible and months since we've prayed and we just don't even know where to go. Wherever we're at, Lord, I pray that you meet us in that place. Because you love us, because you promise that you are faithful and you've shown yourself faithful. Lord, may we be a church that responds faithfully to what you're doing and what you're calling us to be. Thank you for our salvation only possible through your Son, Jesus Christ, and what he has done and what he continues to do in our lives. May we seek you, may we find blessing in that, Lord. So be honored by our prayers, be honored by our songs, be honored by our attention to you this morning and beyond. We love you, and all of this we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. Well, I'm glad that you are all here today and got here safely. Over the past couple of weeks, if you've not been able to join us the past couple weeks, I really do encourage you to go on the church website and listen to the past messages. What we're talking about is sort of the direction, big picture direction of where God is calling us as a church. What should our focus be going forward? Thinking about our mission or our purpose, which is love God completely, love others selflessly. This is the why behind everything we do. This is the why we exist. I just saw a video this week actually put out by the denomination about some stuff that's changing. And this one pastor put it so brilliantly about mission. She said, mission is our compass, guiding our decision-making, guiding our direction, where we go and where we don't go. And this scriptural phrase that Jesus gives us is our compass going forward. What we do needs to fall under this mission. If it isn't about loving God completely and loving others selflessly, we're not going to do it. And if it is about these things, we will do it and should be doing it. So this is our mission going forward. And so this is the why behind everything we do, the how we specifically feel God calling us to live into this mission is our vision. which we laid out last couple weeks, engaging in intentional opportunities for inclusive worship, regularly serving others, and building closer relationships through small groups in order to fulfill our mission. Now, last week, we looked at the inclusive worship section of this vision statement. That inclusive worship is where everyone is welcome in our church. Inclusive worship is where everyone is welcome in our church to be a part of our ministries and to experience the transforming love of Jesus, to experience that love that takes us from where we are and makes us into something new, makes us look more like Christ. Inclusive worship includes all people so that all lives may be encountered and changed by Jesus Christ. More on that, you can look at the message from last week. Talked about that last week. But in order to make this vision and this mission happen, really all of us together need to be a church that looks to Jesus as our model for the type of selfless love that we're talking about, the type of selfless love that we are aspiring to. Jesus is our model for that. And in the Gospel of John, chapter 13, we see Jesus' selfless love on full display. That in John 13, Jesus is hours away from facing his arrest and his trial, if you can even call it a trial, and eventually his crucifixion. And he's in this upper room. He wants to show his closest friends and his closest followers how much he loves them. And so after sharing a meal together, Jesus leaves the table. He ties a towel around his waist, and Jesus Christ kneels down like a servant and carefully washes the feet of the disciples. He washes the feet of Judas, the one who would betray him. He washes the feet of Peter, the one who would deny him and disown him. And one by one, even though in a matter of hours, all of these disciples would, most of them at least, would scatter and run in fear and leave Jesus on his own, he washes their feet. He serves them and shows them how much he loves them. So after he does this, Jesus stood to teach them. And he said this in John 13, starting in verse 13. Jesus says, "You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, because that's what I am. And since I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you ought to wash each other's feet. I have given you an example to follow. Do as I have done for you. Do as I have done to you." An essential aspect of being a Christ follower is modeling the servanthood of Jesus. An essential aspect of being a Christ follower is modeling the servanthood of Jesus, that we are all called to serve. We are all called to be in ministry. And this service-oriented, foot-washing type of ministry is necessary really in two main areas. The first is in the church, that we are all called to serve and minister in the church. Acts chapter 2 tells us about the early first century church. In my Sunday school class this week, we looked at some instructions for this early church, and it was a very different world back then, a very different time. But I think there's a lot that we can learn from the characteristics of this first century church. And so in Acts chapter 2, it says this about the early church. All the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to fellowship, to sharing in meals, including the Lord's Supper, and to prayer. A deep sense of awe came over them all, and the apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders. All the believers met together in one place and shared everything they had. Verse 45, they sold their property and their possessions and shared the money with those in need. Sharing everything they had. This early church is a community of Christ followers that are devoted to one another. Sharing meals in each other's homes. Sharing their finances, selling off all their stuff and sharing their finances together. This is not a weekly one-hour gathering. This is a community. What is described here is a family of brothers and sisters willing to serve one another. Later on, the Apostle Paul, who was a man used by God to establish churches like this all over the Mediterranean, one of the most successful missionary ever. He wrote this about our role in this type of church community. To the church in Ephesus, he writes this. He says, "From him," meaning Christ, "from him," meaning Christ, "the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work." As each part does its work. As each part of the church community does its work. We are all called to serve and minister in the church. Also, we are called to serve and minister beyond the church. And when it comes to serving others, when it comes to our command to serve others, Jesus did not mess around with this, okay? He did not keep it vague. He did not keep it secretive. He explicitly lays out what our expectations are, or his expectations are for us. In Matthew 25, starting in verse 31, Jesus says, "But when the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit upon his glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered in his presence, and he will separate the people as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will place the sheep at his right hand and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the creation of the world. For I was hungry and you fed me. I was thirsty and you gave me a drink. I was a stranger and you invited me into your home. I was naked and you gave me clothing. I was sick and you cared for me. I was in prison and you visited me.' Then these righteous ones will reply, 'Lord, when did we ever see you hungry and feed you? Or thirsty and give you something to drink? Or a stranger and show you hospitality? Or naked and give you clothing? When did we ever see you sick or in prison and visit you?' And the king will say, 'I tell you the truth. When you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you were doing it to me.'" In Matthew 25, Jesus spells out the expectations for his followers, for the subjects of his kingdom, where he is reigning as king. Going out to meet the needs of the poor, to address the needs of the hungry, the naked, the oppressed, the sick, the imprisoned. These kind of actions are not going above and beyond. It is a primary and required task of who we are as the church. And in this passage, Jesus tells us that his heart is so closely linked to these people who are in need that when we serve them, we are serving him. And so conversely, the passage goes on, I didn't address it, but conversely, when we ignore or neglect the poor and the needy, we ignore and neglect Christ. It's not enough for us to have our church doors open and inclusive to those who are in need, like we talked about last week. That's a good start. But the church, us, we, must go out and personally engage with the poor and the needy and the oppressed and offer them the love of Christ. Back to our vision. Engaging in intentional opportunities for inclusive worship, regularly serving others, and building closer relationships through small groups in order to fulfill our mission. So what do I mean by regularly serving others? What does that look like? What's that going to look like for us? What are we going to do with this beyond just a statement? Really, the heart behind this part of the vision statement, the heart behind regularly serving others, is that everyone in our church has a regular, ongoing ministry of service to others, both inside the church and beyond the church. I'm going to say that again because I don't want you to miss it. The heart behind this part of the vision statement, the heart behind regularly serving others, is that everyone in our church has a regular, ongoing ministry of service to others, both in the church and beyond the church. And currently, there are many people in our church who are doing this already and doing a really, really good job. That they have an ongoing place to serve in the church, maybe many places to serve in the church. And they also have a cause that they are passionate about outside the church, that they are giving their time and their energy and their resources to. And that is really good, and I celebrate that. And I want that for all of us. We are called to be in ministry to, for, and with those within our church family and to those outside of our church. That regularly serving others is about finding your ministry, finding our ministry. That if someone were to ask you, what is your ministry in the church? You have an answer. If someone were to ask you, how are you ministering to those outside of your church family? We all have an answer. The heart behind this, what we're going for. So how do we determine what our ministry should be? There's lots of different things we could be doing, so inside the church and beyond. So how do we know what we should be doing? To help determine and kind of put us in the right direction, maybe, there's four things that I think we need to be considering. The first is, for us individually, is my passions. Asking ourselves, what am I passionate about? What am I passionate about? What do I love to do? What cause or issue breaks my heart? I just can't get it out of my mind. What do I wish more people cared about? What cause or maybe type of ministry gets me fired up, either in a good way because you get excited about participating in it, or in a way that you have this sense of righteous anger because there's something wrong in our world and I need to do something about it. What am I passionate about? I'm going to embarrass a couple people, and I'm okay with that. An example of this kind of person in our church is Griff Smith. Okay, Griff is going to call me out later, and it'll be all right, and I love him. Griff loves teaching. He loves teaching. He gets excited about teaching. Teaching other people has been his passion for decades, and he's really, really good at it. So it makes sense for Griff to be teaching in the church. He is a Sunday school teacher. He is a Bible study leader, and he does a great job at that. That's an example of somebody serving alongside their passions in the church. An example of those outside of our church and in our community serving beyond our walls are the people who serve in the food pantry. And I know Janet's hiding outside in the narthex because she's scared, but I'll single her out too. I can see her even though she thinks I can't see her. Janet and those who serve at the food pantry are in tune with the fact that it is a problem that people in our community don't have food. That it is wrong that people in our community are going hungry. Thank God that there are people like Janet and all the people who help out at the food pantry who are passionate enough to do something about that problem. And they are feeding hundreds of people a month. And it is a beautiful thing to see. It takes a lot of hard work and a lot of passion. I'm thankful that they do it. So the first thing to consider when we're looking at, okay, what do I serve? What do I do? God, where should I serve in the church and outside the church? First thing to consider is, what are you passionate about? The second thing to consider are your gifts. My gifts, what are my gifts? For this, you just ask yourself, what am I good at? What comes naturally to me? What are my particular set of skills? It's the best Liam Neeson impression you will ever hear from a pastor. I guarantee it. Okay, what am I good at? What have I learned to do over my career or over my life? That God has created all of us uniquely, that we are all different, and that is great. We have unique skills, we have unique abilities and unique gifts in order to show people the love of Christ through how we serve them, in order to build up the church. In Romans chapter 12, I'm using a lot of Paul today. Feel free to follow up and look this up on your own. Romans 12, verse 1. Paul writes, "And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you, give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him." A couple verses later, Paul gets really specific about what he means with this. Verse 6, he says, "In his grace, God has given us different gifts for doing certain things well. So if God has given you the ability to prophesy, speak out with as much faith as God has given you." Verse 7, "If your gift is serving others, serve them well. If you are a teacher like Griff, teach well." I keep embarrassing him because it's just so easy. "If your gift is if your gift is to encourage others, be encouraging. If it is giving, give generously. If God has given you leadership ability, take the responsibility seriously. And if you have a gift of showing kindness to others, do it gladly. Use these things that God has made you for. You are who you are for a specific reason. You are different from the people in the pew in front of you and the pew behind you for a reason. It is to worship God, it is to glorify him, it is to build up the church, it is to serve others. So are we using our gifts to serve and minister to others in the church and outside of the church? The next thing to consider are the needs around us. These are the things that go beyond us, beyond our gifts, beyond our personalities, beyond our passions. These are just the practical needs around us. So asking, what needs are there in my church? What are the needs of the people in my community? What needs are there out in the world? Sometimes the needs around us don't necessarily coincide with our passions. Sometimes our passions are over here, but there's this need right here, and they're not really in line with each other. Sometimes there's a need right here, but we can say, you know what? My gift is really over here. Well, this is still a need. There are practical needs that aren't always going to align with our passions and our gifts, but there's still things that need to get done. For instance, in order for us to have a church that is intentionally inclusive, intentionally welcoming, we have greeters, we have ushers, we have people who make coffee, we have people who care for our little ones. Now, I don't think any of us are particularly passionate or gifted at making coffee, but somebody's doing it. I don't think a lot of people would say they're necessarily passionate or gifted about holding a fussy baby so that their parents can be in worship. But every week there are people who are doing it. There are things that just need to get done. And if you are a member or regular attender at Trinity, if you are a member or regular attender at Trinity, if this is your church home, you are expected to get involved and help with these things that need to get done. On each pew, in the middle side of each pew, are one of these sheets. I ask you to, if you're at the end of the aisle, if you could take one of these and pass it down to the rest of the people in your pew, I'd really appreciate that. On this sheet is simply a list of needs. And again, if you are like first, second, third time visitor, and you're like, man, they're going to make me start making coffee, this is more for people who have been here for a while. So don't feel like we're going to pressure you to do that. But on one side of this sheet are Sunday morning service opportunities, Sunday morning needs. Now, on the other side is a list of all of our ministry teams. This is more ongoing leadership roles in the church that still need to get done. I'm asking you to look through this throughout the service, after service. I'm asking each person here to find a place to get involved, to put their name and their contact info on this sheet, and mark at least one area where you can get involved, where you can serve in the church. And when you mark that, you're not signing up to be making coffee forever and ever. What I'm asking you to do is simply mark one of these things that you feel like you can do, that you might want to be a part of, and someone will reach out to you about what that role entails. That's all I'm asking. This is not, I'm committing to be an usher until the day I die. This is, if you write usher, somebody will call you about, what does it mean to be an usher? How often do we need you? What do they do on a Sunday morning? Is there training? What other follow-up is there? So you're asking for information, but I'm asking that every single person here fill this out. Even if you are already doing something, if you already are an usher, if you already are on finance team, then put your name and put that you're doing those things. Maybe if you want to do something else, mark that too. If you're doing too many things, then don't put anything. But if you, and then after you fill this out, there's that box in the back that we've had throughout this service. As you leave, fold this, put it in the box in the back. We need people to get involved. We need more people to get involved. If you consider Trinity your church family, please find a place to serve. There are also obviously many, many needs outside of our church. And I intended to have a list of all the different ways that we can serve in our community and beyond, but there's honestly way too many to list. There are lots of different ways that we can get involved in our town, in our region, in our nation, and in our world. So what I'm asking us to do is for us to find a place beyond the church for us to serve in that resonates with our passions and get our hands dirty in something beyond the church. I've been having really good conversations with Christy Adams, who does an awesome job leading our outreach team. I'm embarrassing lots of people today. If you do really good stuff in the church, I'm going to call you out on it. But Christy Adams does a fantastic job, and what we're planning to do is provide quarterly service opportunities for service, for different places that we can serve in our community, for people to really fall in love with serving somewhere outside the church. Fall in love with some cause or passion or ministry or charity or need that is out there that you can regularly commit your time to. And for this, I know I'm preaching to myself more than anybody else because I know I want this for my life. I want this for my family. That everything I do basically regarding service involves the church. I want to find a place where I can give back regularly in the community, where I can be serving, that isn't just sporadic and here and there, but a place I know that I can call my ministry outside the church. If you have ideas about service opportunities, if you are super passionate about this, if you are like me and you're like, you know what, I know I need that too, there's a place on this form too, on the serve side with the tree. On the bottom it says, I would like more information about service opportunities outside the church. Check that box and put that in there too. Also, Christy is going to be in the back. I've asked her to be kind of hang around. I guess, Christy, can you be by the Tops cart so people know exactly where to meet you? If you have questions or ideas about ways that we can be serving, maybe you have an awesome idea for an outreach event upcoming. Talk to Christy about it. Christy is an incredible person to be able to get you plugged in different places. She has a great heart for helping other people. And so she can help steer you in the right direction regarding where to serve others. Lastly, speaking of being steered in the right direction, the fourth and most important thing we need to be considering about where to be serving is God's calling. What is God calling me to do? Where is God leading me? It is very likely that God will use a combination of your passions, your gifts, and the needs around you to clarify this call. But hearing God's calling is all about availability. Are we available enough to hear and to listen and to feel where God is calling us, what he wants from us in this season of our life right now? Hearing God's calling stems from our relationship with him. And our service to others is an act of worship. It's an act of worship that goes beyond this service. So what does our Savior and Lord require of us in this season of our lives? An essential aspect of being a Christ follower is modeling the servanthood of Jesus. But there's an added blessing in it. Loving and serving others is a tremendous blessing. I have never once in my life given my time to serve others and regretted it. Not one time. Not a service trip with teenagers, not a Saturday afternoon because somebody needed help, not anything. As I have given my time selflessly to someone else, then thought, man, you know what? I really wish I'd have stayed home and watched TV. That was an absolute waste of time. I hated that. I wish I was just home. I wish I had more time for me in that moment. I've never thought that, because when we serve, we encounter God's blessing. Jesus says in Matthew 25, when you're feeding the hungry, when you're clothing the naked, when you're visiting the imprisoned, you're doing it for me. You're meeting me in that moment. We encounter Christ in a unique way when we serve other people. I want that blessing for us. I want that blessing in our church, for every individual, every family, to regularly experiencing knowing Christ through serving him and serving others. So if you don't have a ministry you are involved in with the church, get involved. We put these in your pew for a reason, to make this as easy as possible. Get involved, or at least ask about what it means to be getting more involved. And if you don't have a place to be serving outside the church, find a place to serve that is in line with these things. What are you passionate about? What are you good at? What needs do you see around you? And what direction is God pulling you? Use your answers to these questions to find your ministry in the church and beyond the church. Let's pray as the band comes up and closes us in worship. Lord God, we thank you for your purpose and calling on our lives. That it is a ridiculous thing to think that you want to work with us. That we have very limited things to offer. We mess up all the time. We don't always hear your voice. We don't always see the needs, but you are continually calling us to partner with you. Thank you, Lord, for giving us that purpose and seeing our potential and giving us that gift of working alongside the God of the universe to bring out good things in the world, to build up the church, to address needs in our community and beyond. So, Lord, I pray that you give us this passion, that you give us this drive to get involved, to see the needs, to acknowledge our gifts, and to hear where you are calling us to serve. And may we be faithful to your calling, Lord Jesus, we pray. Thank you for your church, and thank you for everything you're doing in and through us. It is in your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Community and beyond who need you, but that love may be so much more than a song or a prayer or a sermon. May we love with actions and with truth. So Lord, guide us toward what you are calling us to. Maybe it's a new type of ministry in the church. Maybe it's simply seeing, hey, there's people who serve there every week. I can do that. I can give an extra half hour. Maybe it is a longing of your heart, of our hearts, that you have just been pulling us toward this issue, seeing that need, seeing that issue in our world, and finally us saying, yes, Lord, I'm willing to do something about that, willing to be used by you to address that. So, Lord, guide us toward what you are calling us to be. We are all ministers. You have made us to be all ministers and your representatives in the world. So as we go from this place, may we go representing Christ. May people see Christ in our love, in our action, in our selflessness, in our willingness to passionately address wrongs and injustices in our world. And through all of it, Lord Jesus, may you be glorified. So may our worship go beyond this place. May our worship be so much more than singing. But through every moment of our lives, we pray. Thank you, Lord, for your calling on our lives. All this we pray in your Son's holy name. And all of God's people said together, amen.
Amen.
Amen. It's great worshiping with you. Drive safe as you head home or wherever you are going today. And hopefully we will see you next week. Please remember to fill out your sheets and put it in the box in the back right behind Brendan. And we will see you next Sunday. Have a good week. Amen.